Inaugural Lecture. My name is Karis Bradley, I'm going to be your MC for this evening. Essentially what that means is every time I hop on stage, and by stage I mean this surprisingly stained amount of carpet at the front of the lecture theatre. That means that I'm about to introduce someone very interesting to come and talk to you, so that's your cue to finish your conversations, pop away your phones, probably like turn them off for the next hour and a half, you'll thank me. That's going to be my job. I'm also here to do a little bit of housekeeping. So there is no scheduled fire alarm this evening, which means that if the fire alarm goes off, it is an indication that we need to leave the building. Your fire exits are at the back of the lecture theatre and also to the side of the lecture theatre, and they'll all make a very reasonable and safe and steady exit from this lecture theatre and from the building itself. So that's what I'm sort of here to do. And tonight we're going to hear from a number of different people. We're obviously going to hear from Sarah herself, but we're going to have a short introduction from Professor Alan Penn, and we're also going to hear some respondents from some of Sarah's colleagues and friends and students who are also going to talk to you. So first things first, to kick things off, we're going to hear a short introduction from Professor Penn, who is the Dean of the Bartlett Faculty of Building Design, Built Design, Environmental.
Well done.
One job, I've already messed it up. I'm very sorry. Bartlett, you told me just to say the Bartlett, I shouldn't have said the Bartlett. Why am I still talking? I don't know. You can end this by putting your hands together and
Sarah joined at UCL back in about 2005, and I seem to remember this because it was not long before she was all over the whole institution. And it's actually, she's one of the most visible people across the institution that has been in many years. It's actually really nice to see such a crowd of people in here and to see them from so many different parts of UCL as well. There's a trick, of course, to this, and that is that if you're going to give an inaugural, move faculty and department just before. Now you get at least two. Right, so she responded to an open advertisement and there were, I think, nine recruits into civil engineering at the time, as it was then called, because it was before it was merged with geomatic engineering. And she arrived from Down Under, from Sydney, and she soon started the MSc in Environmental Systems Engineering and won the Excellence in Teaching Award from the Royal Academy of Engineering. And she's graduated about 300 students by now through that programme, so that's quite something, actually. She also started to do a whole series of things across UCL. I said she was very visible, and the reason she was very visible is that she got around, she started working across disciplinary boundaries. It's not surprising for somebody who is working in an engineering department but is actually a social scientist of some kind. The nature of interdisciplinarity across UCL is such that it really encourages people to get out and about if they're up to it. She turned out to be up to it. So she started up a whole series of new research partnerships focusing around urban sustainability. And more recently, she's focused on community engagement. And of course, these are closely related. Sustainability in an environment in which you're not engaging with your communities doesn't really work. And I think we may hear a bit more about that as we go on. So she won an EPSRC Living with Environmental Change Research Fellowship, and that's been a major support for what she's been doing more recently. And then she moved just last year over to the Bartlett into the Institute for Environmental Design and Engineering that gets the pop-up, you see. That could have been CG, but no. And that was because her interests had really evolved much more towards a holistic view of built environments, and it felt like the right thing to do. So we're very pleased to welcome Sarah into the Faculty of Built Environment and into the Bartlett, and all of those areas that come in that world. Now, along the way, Sarah's been involved in some really innovative academic projects. In 2013, she co-convened the UCL LU project with Barbara Penner and Huite. And what they did was they built a toilet in the front quad. It happened to be a very sustainable composting toilet, and it was one of those sort of really quite memorable events in UCL to get Mark McGrath, I think it was at the time. Was it?
It was newly appointed.
First thing that Michael Arthur did was to approve the erection of the loo in the front quad. Anyway. She also coordinated the engineering thinking module on the BASC Liberal Arts Programme, or Liberal Arts and Sciences Programme, and she convinced UCL Estates to let first-year students learn plumbing. The way to do that is to take the toilets at the South Junction and make sure they never work, and then send your students in and they sort them out. It's probably no coincidence that at SMT, at about that time, the female members of SMT started complaining about the quality of the South Junction toilets. And, I mean, this is absolutely memorable. There was just every estates management committee meeting you went to, what came up as the topic of concern, South Junction toilets. Okay. So disruption. disruption is part of what public and community engagement has always been about, and it's been important to Sarah's work right from the beginning, involving community groups in her teaching and her research. Since 2014, she's led the Engineering Exchange. And the Engineering Exchange brings together researchers in engineering, built environments, and local London community groups, and many of you are here this evening. And Sarah was one of the first academics at UCL to sign on also as a Bright Club member. Now, Bright Club is an experiment in training researchers to do stand-up comedy. And we're about to find out how well that's worked. I'm not really any guarantees on this. Okay, thank you.
And I was there talking about my research, which is about drug markets and the dark web. So they were thrilled to have me. The students were actually really excited to meet a real engineer, and then they had to listen to me. But they had their homework was they had to prepare questions, and they all sat there with their blue homework books out on their desk in front of them. They were really, really excited. Like, not 3 minutes into my talk, one child already had their hands up, and they were desperate to know what was my greatest weakness. I was also asked where did I see myself in 5 years. So I really felt like I was being interviewed by 30 11-year-olds. Would you like to know what I said?
Yes.
So I said, I said, my greatest weakness is that I'm not very good at working in a team, and I wish I was more of a team player, because it's really important that you're able to collaborate with people, you have good team working skills, and because when we work together, we can do better things, we can do more things. And as I was saying this, I caught the teacher's eye, and she was absolutely over it. She was like, this is perfect, that was the perfect answer, you're doing so well teaching my kids. She did not like it when the next question, from a very fidgety boy called Kevin in the front row, was how do you get onto the dark web? So that was the end of the talk, and we haven't been invited back. I'm not an engineer, and also clearly not an inspiration, but it's okay, because I am about to introduce you to someone who is both an engineer and also an inspiration. But I need to tell you two things about Sarah before I introduce you. So one thing you will already know, Sarah is not a conventional professor and does not like to do things conventionally. And then the other thing, the line that I was about to say is, you might not know, but Alan has already ruined this joke. What you might not know until 5 minutes ago is that Sarah is also a stand-up comedian. And that is actually how we met. So we met performing stand-up comedy together. She did 8 brilliant minutes about jokes about environmental engineering, which I thought was hilarious and thought-provoking. She did 1 minute about an old boyfriend who was a mathematician, which I liked a little bit less. But I was really glad that I met her, and tonight she's going to do a little bit of stand-up comedy in her inaugural lecture. So this isn't just her inaugural lecture as a professor, it's also sort of her first solo stand-up comedy show. What this means is that if you hear something in Sarah's talk that sounds like it might be a joke, does anyone know the correct response to when you hear something funny? What should you do?
No.
You should laugh, yes. You've all been incredibly generous by laughing at the jokes that I have said. So I know that you are capable. I just want to test it. I just want to see how much you can laugh. So I'm going to tell you a joke that Sarah told me, and also told me that her grandfather told me. So we know that it's a good one, because it's been passed down through the generations. What happened to the mathematician that was constipated? She worked it out with a pencil. So for Sarah's jokes, less groaning, more laughing. In all seriousness though, if you hear something that you think is funny, please laugh. This is such a little weird environment to do stand-up comedy, but the more laughing that you do, the funnier it's going to seem. If you hear everyone else laughing and you're not laughing, I suggest that you also laugh, because otherwise people will just think that you haven't understood the joke. So do we think that we're ready for this?
Yes!
Amazing. Then please put your hands together and welcome to the Lecture Theatre Carpet, Professor Sarah Bell.
You might be wondering.
to university.
So, first of all, the thanks. Now, I'm not going to name names because there's too many people and that would just take us all night. But what I want you to do is if you hear me say thanks to someone that sounds like you, put your hand up. Okay, so you need to participate in the thanks. We've got a big event coming to And finally, thanks to the rest of the gang. Yes. So these are my friends and family from here and in Australia. Hi to those guys, because we're videos for them later, and they're all asleep tonight. So thanks to all of them for whom most of them, none of this academic business really meant very much at all. And that's really important for me, keeping my priorities straight. So now, to the talk. The other thing you need to know about inaugural lectures is that they tend to be a celebration of the subject. They mostly focus on the positive aspects of the professor's work. This lecture, not so much. So I am going to talk to you about engineering, but I'm not going to tell you how great engineering is. If that's what you're after, watch top gear. Certainly reduce the audience numbers at the moment. And so I will talk about engineering, but I might give the impression at some point during this lecture that I don't love all of engineering ever. That might come as a bit of a shock to some of you, but too late. They're already making it pass up. Now, engineering will save the world. Oh, I'm going backwards. Professor. We have the technology. So, engineering will save the world, or various versions of that slogan, are used by engineers to recruit young, unsuspecting, idealistic people into our universities and professions. Now, it's not always clear what we're saving the world from, but there's no doubt that engineers are important. Now, UCL engineering, rarer than most, our slogan is change the world. We don't say if that's changing for the better. And the thing is, though, that when I was young, we didn't have
rather than a rectangle.
But you get the picture. So, built a sports stadium. Or at least part of the sports stadium. And, you know, fair enough now, you're probably looking at that thinking, that's a bit of a rubbish sports stadium. And the truth is that it has been demolished. But still, so, built a football stand. And it wasn't her fault that it was the 1980s. drum started to rust and the guitar started to work out again. And so then they put in some more drums until that started to rust and work out again. And so this was this very productive, what you might call even circular economy. and it was quite lucrative for the contractor that was desperate enough to cut a car every day. And it was really good business for the people who make drums. But it was not good for the smelter and it was not good for the environment. So eventually, the managing director of the aluminium company wrote a very famous memo. This was like an actual physical memo, a piece of paper that someone had typed and photocopied and distributed to everybody in the carbon plant. And in that memo, he said that the tar stockpile was a disgrace and we all needed to stop wishing that a tar fairy would come along and magic away the tar. So, it was 1996, so something needed to be done. Now, it was 1997, and I had just arrived at Sinatra. I got my first job out of university. I'm a bright, new graduate engineer, ready to be like Sue. And I was going to be even better than Sue because I was an environmental engineer. So I was literally going to use engineering to save the planet. So I got myself a job at the biggest aluminium smelter in Australia. It was one of the biggest in the world. And I get there and I find out that they have really big plans for me. I am the tar fairy. And I tried my hardest. So I was assigned this task to get rid of the tar. And I ran lots of experiments. I ran experiments to try and see how we could use the tar as a raw material rather than thinking of it as a waste product. We looked at burning it in power stations. We looked at burning it in cement kilns. We even looked at how we might recycle it back into producing more carbon anodes. I failed. I spilled tar, otherwise nice and tidy parts of the smelter. One of my experiments shut down the entire carbon anode production facility for several days, which may have actually done more to slow down climate change than if I'd become vegan for the rest of my life. Just like becoming vegan, that seemed to really annoy a lot of other people. So I couldn't find anything useful to do with the tar, so I started looking at waste disposal facilities, waste management contractors. And eventually the managing director signed off a six-figure sum for someone, anyone, take the tar off our hands. Which is every girl's dream, really, to be given a big check, told to go shopping at industrial waste facilities. So I sent out tender documents, and we had about half a dozen companies come back and said that they had a plan for taking our money and our time. And so we're all set to go, except as a very diligent young environmental engineer, I had inserted into the tender documents that we needed to do an environmental audit of their facilities, which proved to be somewhat of a constraint in my ability to deliver on the project objective of making the tar disappear. So I went off to audit these potential contractors, and so I hopped in an airplane, because you can never burn too much carbon, and I flew to not have a waste disposal facility. He was just planning on taking our money and our tower and selling it on to someone else. And so I had visions of 20 years into the future, in the year 2018, on the outskirts of Melbourne, some new, beautiful suburban housing estate, celestial gardens, and children coming running over to their parents, saying, "Daddy, Daddy, the sand, sticky." Tumor growing over there. So we did not give the tower to Tony, and we did not give Tony any of that money. And then I went to Adelaide and had some slightly less criminal conversations with waste management industry there before I flew back to Queensland, back to my bosses, a shameful failure of a tower ferry, and told them that I didn't think the Australian waste management industry was quite ready for our tower. And that my recommendation as an engineer was that we just leave it sitting on our site rotting, or at least we knew where it was. And to their credit, they agreed. And this remains one of my proudest engineering achievements. Doing nothing. So, I made sure a pile of toxic, carcinogenic waste stayed right where it was. And a few years after my time, the managers of the smelter did manage to negotiate for the tar to be disposed of in a secure landfill, the stockpile of tar. And for any new tar that was being produced, future generations of tar fairies have, as far as I know, so have managed to find a way of recycling it back into the production. So the smelter did get to the right answer eventually, but for me, I had started out thinking that good engineers build stuff. I was wrong. My best engineering was to do nothing. Now, we always teach engineers to evaluate options, but the do nothing option is always the wrong answer. Do nothing is what academics do. And there I was, an aspiring engineer with this big project, and do nothing turned out to be the best answer. It was the best answer for the environment, it was best for the smelter's legal liabilities, and it was the best answer for the future generations of children playing in suburban developments on the outskirts of Melbourne. Now, if all of this sounds like put it into my computer, hoping that it would spit out some references to relevant journal articles. And I got the journals off the shelf, which were these massive hardcover books. Dropped them, it would break your toe. And I photocopied half a dozen journal articles, and I drove home again and I started writing my essay. I don't remember what I wrote, but I do remember getting to the end of the first draft of that essay and looking up and thinking, far out. As my entire career disappeared in a puff of ethical crisis. Because it turns out that climate change actually is a big deal, ethically speaking. And it's wrong to just keep pumping out carbon dioxide so that we can make more and more zippers. Now, aluminium local London communities, and we help them to do projects together. And the Faculty of Engineering provided some funding so that I could spend my time setting up the engineering exchange, and also for Charlotte Barrow to be able to work with me. And the Bartlett also provides some funding. We've had funding from the Natural Environment Research Council, the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, and the Royal Academy of Engineers. And over the 4 years that we've been running, we've run more than 20 projects. We've had hundreds of people involved in our work. And we've worked on topics like housing, air pollution, transport, green infrastructure. And one example of that is the Engineering Comes Home project. So the Engineering Comes Home project was really about how can we do engineering differently? How can we do engineering with communities rather than for them? That kind of research is not that easy to get funded. So now that I'm a professor, I can tell you all the secret to success as an engineering researcher is to take your ideas and try and make them fit with what the research councils want to fund. Now, a few years ago, the research councils were funding work in what's called the water, energy, food nexus. So this is the idea that we need water to grow food, and we also need water to cool power stations. We need energy to pump and treat water, and we need energy to transport food. So all of these things are interconnected, and they're all going to get more difficult all at once with climate change, population growth, and increasing consumption. Now, when engineers typically talk about this problem, they look to the big infrastructure systems, the things that they nothing wrong with that. But I think when we're getting the kids to build the spaghetti towers, we should at least be honest with them about what engineering is really about. And if we are serious about engineering to change the world for the better, then we could start by doing engineering differently. We could re-engineer engineering. We might acknowledge that doing nothing is sometimes the best option. Sometimes the best engineering solution is no engineering. We could do more projects that involve lots of small things with lots of benefits rather than one big thing that makes money, that is creates work for engineers and makes money for their clients and investors. And we could try out more of these ways of working with communities rather than for or against them. Now, engineers like Sue do a great job. She was an inspiration for my career. Big engineering is sometimes the right answer. Sometimes you do just need more water. I do not even want to think about what the South Junction toilets would be like if we ran out of water. But big is not always best. Engineers do have a lot to offer the world, but our ideas of what engineering is need to open up. I think that more engineers should have ethical crises, and they should spend more time cooking and eating spaghetti
from an engineering job where I was designing green mixed-use developments that were to have lower carbon dioxide consumption and lower water consumption, but they were also built to bypass lots of shared big infrastructure. So my question was, what happens to us as a collective of city running people when we stop, when we never start sharing water and sanitation systems? So I rocked up to UCL to do my PhD, and arriving in the civil engineering department in 2004 and then being supervised by Sarah Bell was actually a bit like climate change. We have this sense that something significant is happening, but just as it's hard to see the Anthropocene when you're actually in it, all the implications of what was going on, the disruption, the curriculum changes, the arrival of this tall Australian academic weren't clear at the time. So hearing now, in 2018, about the engineering exchange, your research, the people involved, is so interesting to look back at those shifts in the early 2000s and ponder how the hell we managed to carve out space to go off-piste and collaborate really in radical ways. So doing nothing is clearly an excellent course of action. But to be taught or supervised by Sarah is really to have your thinking changed. I remember you telling me about that aluminium plant and how it made you question everything, really, and go back to university. What I couldn't get my head around was your PhD research. You have this incredible photo up on the wall of this windswept child in a really barren place. And in fact, it's not that different, that image, from some of the pictures of drought-stricken Australia that have been in the news in the last few weeks. But it turned out that photograph was taken in the place you were from. You did your research on the farmland with people you knew, alongside the farmers who were eating and tending that land. To me, it seemed sort of futuristic, ahead of its time, like Mad Max, but it was also, it was personal. I didn't know research could be personal. I didn't know engineering implicated. I thought knowledge came in just one format. I hadn't really thought about subjectivity or lived experiences. You told me, half joking back then, that between winding up your PhD and hearing about your UCL fellowship, this might be familiar to a lot of you, your flatmate would frequently find you in the fetal position on the sofa. Because actually, if you really do confront the nexus between our ways of life, technology, politics, frailty, and people we care about, it is really hard to know what to do. But you ended up doing such cool things. That engineering thinking course that people have talked about, it wasn't just plumbing, it was electronics and philosophy in one course. Who knew? The MSc module on sustainable urban drainage is probably sort of one of the only ones in the country, and even the Financial Times in the last few weeks has been endorsing sustainable urban drainage as an alternative to the big Thames tideway. You were teaching undergrads about Basel Jet, about John Snow, not that one, and explaining the significance to students of sitting in the Chadwick building to learn about public health. You were supervising PhDs on water systems in Peru, the history of London's water supplies, ethnographies of engineers in practice. So much, nothing tight stuff. So that's the piece of advice I wanted to touch on, your teaching, but I also wanted to touch on the future, your professional, your professorial leadership. How do you found time to lead, to learn to lead, and to grow as a leader? How does this work in an institution like UCL? When we spoke about this talk, you mentioned what you described as a duty to pay attention. You carry this commitment not just to doing the work or serving to lead, but to noticing the imbalances, the exploitations, and to ask questions about who is modelling what kind of work ethic to young academics during their long apprenticeships. I'm not sure if any of you know that old military adage that warns of the mischief caused by those who are both diligent and foolish, but it claims that anyone who is both clever and lazy is qualified for the highest leadership duties. There are two truisms here. One is the luxury of authority, the luxury to voice an opinion without having to scrabble for an arsenal of evidence every time. And also, that rising through a hierarchy is not always in recognition of the labour, the long toil of learning. With your colleagues and your students, you've somehow found a balance between getting on with the work, making things happen, connecting the dots, connecting people, and also holding the space to pay attention and to steer a course. And knowing how hard academics really do work, at this supposed nothingness, I think instead I'm going to, and I'd like to join me in rebranding and celebrating Sarah's version of Doing Nothing as Doing Nothing Conventional. Keep it up.
Mad woman that we all love, and help people find solutions that really will make a difference.